Hey guys, my name is Atticus Todd, for those who don't know me. We're in sunny California in front of the Inosanto World Famous Academy. I'm a senior instructor here, and this is where Billy and I met. Billy attended pretty much every class I ever taught. He's very willing to work really hard. I love the way that he would treat the lower students than him. It's the kind of thing that I nurture and encourage, and I never had to with Billy. It's just naturally how he was. Billy had a smile that could just light up the room. Everybody liked him. I mean, everybody liked him. I got to know him pretty well. We got pretty close. We'd hang out afterwards. We'd go and get soup or whatever's going on, right? He'd hang out with me while I was having a cigar. We have a lot of heart-to-hearts, and he had a lot of stuff to talk about, right? Billy was a deep, thoughtful guy. I know you're gonna miss him, because we're gonna miss him. I'm very sorry for your loss.
Hello there, my name is David Anderson. I'm a student at the Inosanto Academy of Martial Arts, and I just wanted to say a couple of words about Billy. I only met Billy a few times and trained with him, but the moment I met him, I instantly liked him. He was a great training partner and a really just nice, really nice guy. And I'm just so sorry to hear about his passing. And I just want to say my condolences to his family. He was really a sweet guy. So thank you very much, and take care. Bye-bye.
Oh, no. All right, I got it.
And okay, whenever you're ready here.
Hi, I'm Dan Otisano, and I was one of Billy's instructors, and Billy's going to be greatly missed by us. We love him. Like, know it to his friends and the family. Again, God bless you and comfort you at this time. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Johnny. When I heard Billy passed away, I'm very shocking and very sad. I know Billy when I first moved to LA, and he was really open-armed and kind. He introduced me to a lot of different stunts and martial arts academies, and just helped me when I was at really low point of my life. And I'm sorry for the loss, and rest in peace.
My name is Monique, and I first met Billy at the Inosanto Academy. I had taken a 20-year break from training, so when I came back, I was an utter beginner, and I didn't really have anyone to train with. But Billy, even though his skill was way above mine, was always willing to train with me. He was very helpful in giving me such great boxing tips. But you know what I really appreciated about Billy the most was just his humility. Even though he was a fantastic martial artist, he always came to class willing to learn and just being humble about even what he knew and just wanting to know more. So it was just such a pleasure to be around him. What I also remember is that sometimes before class, I would see him sitting on the bench, and we would get to chat about his family, and just he would brag about how much he just loves Jack, and just smile from ear to ear when he would talk about his family. I also had the privilege of getting to know Roseanne a little bit, and I just love you guys so much. And Billy will always be remembered forever, and just for his kindness and the love that he carried. And Roseanne, I love you, and you are an incredibly strong woman, and I know that God is with you and your family and your boys, and I just wanted to send you all my love and all my best to you. So, thank you.
Hi everyone, my name is Tim Becker. I'm one of the instructors here at the Inosanto Academy of Martial Arts, and I want to extend my condolences to your loss, to the family and friends of Billy. He meant a lot to us here. He was certainly one of our probably more outgoing, friendly students. I remember when he first came to the academy, he was certainly someone that you wanted to step up and talk to and meet, because he always had a big smile and very bright eyes. And as I got to talk to him in class, I realized that we had very similar background as far as martial art lineage, that is. He was a student of Dickie Harrell, who was a partner of Larry Hartzell in the first Jeet Kune Do school outside of California. So I knew that our lineage would match up, and certain terms that Larry Hartzell would use for certain techniques he knew, and we always had a great laugh about that. He was always here for class when he was here, and he was just kind of a go-to guy. He and Christian, who was, you know, his late friend that he was very close to, was also very close to me as well. These were guys that I would always call if I got asked to do a demo somewhere or teach a group or something where I needed some experienced people, and especially another big guy. He'd be one of the first to call, and he was always there. He was always very dependable. Just a wonderful person, and you know, a big loss for everyone. And I got to know him personally outside as well. I mean, it was nice to be able to spend some time with his wife and his son when he was staying here in the Redondo Beach area, and we got to sit and have dinner and kind of be around him, and he seemed like a very proud father and husband. And sad that he's gone, but we'll remember him. We'll always remember him here at the academy, because he was an exemplary student and seemed to really love the place, and we loved him too. So again, keep him in your hearts and your memories, and as we will. Thank you.
My name is Dale Simulton, and God bless everybody's day. I've been knowing Billy for a long time, since the fourth, fifth grade. Basketball coach at Charlotte Latin School, and his parents used to invite me to come over to the house and train him in basketball, and I loved it. I watched him grow up at Charlotte Latin School. He was a fantastic young man, and he loved much. Those who love much, much is forgiven. I want you to remember that. Those who love much, much is forgiven. Billy has an impact on everybody. Everywhere he went, he had an impact. He loved everybody. Have no doubt about it. My son adored Billy. My little boy named Daniel, he adored Billy. Billy could do no wrong. He loved him. He loved him. And as a matter of fact, Billy helped me coach at Central Academy at Lake Park. He was my assistant coach. I was pretty hardcore, like military. Billy had the soft part of it. He would go in there and shoot code everything, and I would go, hey, yo, guys, get ready. We got to go. Billy would go, you know, calm down. We got this. We got this. And my son, Daniel, adored him. And even today, Daniel's hurting. My little Daniel is a junior at Anderson University. He's hurting, just like all of us in here. But I want to remind us, those who love much, much is forgiven. So, Lord, in the name of Jesus, I come before you, knowing that all things work together for our good. And we can attest to that, because you are a good God. You sent your only son to die for us. How much love is that? And then, Lord God, you gave us an opportunity to spend time with Billy. Lord God, to share his time on this earth. And he loved much. So Lord God, I just lift up holy hands and say, thank you for Billy. Thank you for all the people that's here. May we remind ourselves that we too must leave this earth. But while we're here, let's be like Billy. Let's make a difference. Let's love much. Let people remember us because we loved everybody. Billy loved everybody. So we can say, hallelujah, 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 because you're a good God and you have Billy. And we thank you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Stand on mountains. For those of you who know me, you know how much I have loved my family. September the 13th, 1980, was the day that Billy was born. I was there. It was in San Antonio, Texas. And I just couldn't wait to see him. As it was, he took his time getting there. But I'll never forget when we finally were able to see him. There was this big boy, wide-eyed, with the biggest blue eyes you could ever imagine. And it was as though he was just looking at me and saying, I know who you are, Nanny. And while he was still in his mother's womb, and I was in Texas staying with her for a while, she would sit down, and I would put my head on her lap, and I would sing little songs to him. I would tell him how much I loved him and that I just couldn't wait to see him. When he was born, it changed my life. What a gift. What a precious gift. Unfortunately, I was living in New York and he was in San Antonio, Texas. I was working for a school district, but every time we had a holiday, I was in San Antonio. And whenever he could just make utters, I would call Pam and say, put him next to the phone. I just want to hear his little voice. It always made my day. Unfortunately, Pam and Bill were in the service, and they moved around a lot. While they were in San Antonio, they did have another child, Amanda. And I can remember Billy. He absolutely adored her. We never knew what he was going to do to make her laugh, because even then, he was an actor. And I just wanted to say that the greatest gifts, I believe, given to us are children. And along with those gifts, well, God says, this is what you do. You love them unconditionally. Again, Pam and Bill moved a lot. It didn't matter. They left San Antonio and they went to Germany. And guess what? I went to Germany too. And the distance telephone calls still kept going on. From Germany, they went to Maryland, and that was a little closer to New York. So that was better for my husband and I to see the children. And we did. We spent as much time as we possibly could with them. Billy was an exceptional little boy. He was very smart and always, always wanted to know why. Why this? Why that? I think forever, as long as I can remember, he remained that way. Can you tell me why this is like this, Nanny? And I often would say, well, I'm not sure, but I would give it my best shot. Billy and I had a very close relationship. And I'm so thankful. I am so thankful that we were finally able to move to Charlotte, North Carolina, where they were living. I was able, my husband and I, to go to all of his basketball games and just to be a part of their everyday living, even being in the carpool to pick him up when I could. I think back and I wonder how quickly those years go by. I guess I would say the one thing that I've learned in my almost 90 years of life was to live one day at a time, to love as much as you can, to forgive and forget the things that you don't like, and to remember how good God is every day to give us the blessings that he does give us of life. And at the end of the day, what did you do with the time that he gave you? I can honestly say that I loved my children and I loved my grandchildren. And now I have two of the most precious great-grandchildren to love. I never thought, I never dreamed I would ever live this long. Well, that's a blessing, isn't it? Every day I thank God for waking me, and I hear those children in the morning, and I think, wow, this is wonderful. Again, never know what to expect, and that's great. Billy met Roseanne in 2015, and I can remember him saying, Nanny, you just have to meet this woman. She's amazing, and she's beautiful, and she's an Olympic swimmer, and she's all these things, and I love her, Nanny. I love her. So what he did was he married Roseanne July the 10th of 2015. And as a result of that love, we do have Jack, who just turned 6 years old in July, and Jonah, who just turned 2. They're the loves of my life. I honestly don't know what I would do if I didn't hear their voices the first thing in the morning. Roseanne is like a daughter to me. She has been a blessing, and again, I thank God every day for her, because Roseanne, I honestly don't know what I would do without you. We go to church together, and we pray together. We cry together, and we're crazy together. We laugh and just carry on with these two little children. And again, I have to say, what are these? They're blessings. I'm so grateful every day of my life for my grandson, Billy. I'm grateful for almost the 42 years that God gave us to spend with him. And Billy, I know you hear what I'm going to say now, but your mother and father, myself, and Amanda will help Roseanne with these two beautiful boys. I know you hear that, Billy. I can feel your spirit. And I can thank God for all the friends, family, and loved ones that are here today. Thank you.
My name's Jim Case. I'm a friend. It's an honor to be here, Bill, Pam. Thank you for inviting me. Roseanne, Marcel, Mandy, all of the Post and friends and family and loved ones that are here today. It's really an honor. And it's an honor because I got to know Billy really well. Billy was a clown. He was funny. He had a sharp mind. But I didn't know him until he was in the eighth grade. And I had played basketball at Davidson, so I had a son at Latin. And I thought, well, if I'm going to be spending time at Latin, I might as well do something for them if I can. So I volunteered to coach their seventh and eighth grade basketball team. They were foolish enough to accept my offer. I was warned ahead of time that this team was really good. They had a lot of defensive specialists. They had rebounders. They had guys that could handle the ball at the point. They said, this team is going to be very good, so you're going to enjoy this year. Oh, and they said, by the way, there's one kid on the team. He just loves to shoot. I mean, he has never met a shot that he did not love. That's Billy Poston. I said, Billy Poston, huh? So I've got my hands full. I'll have to rein him in, make him part of the team, do that whole thing. Well, it ends up, at the end of the day, that team won 16 games, lost two. That's not the point of young athletes at that age, but that's what we did. And they couldn't help but win. They were that good. Billy played. He started. He was a great teammate. And by the end of the season of that year, in the eighth grade, with that big old smile on his face, I had to force him to shoot. He didn't want to shoot. I said, Billy, when you open, take the shot. He said, no, I'd rather win and I'd rather pass. Well, that was Billy, and that's Billy's life. That's who he is. He cared about other people. He wanted to see other people succeed. He was there for other people. He gave his heart to other people. He worked his butt off in practice, and I was pretty tough, no question about that, but I had a good heart, so I didn't abuse the kids. But what I remember most about him personally with me at that age, when I got to know who he really was as a person, besides what I just told you, was that before practice started, we'd always shoot around. Everybody should get a ball, shoot around, have fun, loosen up before practice actually started. So I'd get out there and shoot, and all the kids would want to imitate Coach Case. So they try to make the shots that I made. Of course, Billy would make most of his. Some of the other guys wouldn't. But Billy was relentless. He would not let go. Coach, don't start practice yet. I want to make more shots. I want to shoot more. Come on, Coach. Come on, Coach K. So he'd literally circle around me. He would never leave me alone. It's almost like, Billy, would you please just kind of get out of the way? Let me start the practice. That was Billy. He was obsessed. He was obsessed with what he did. And so when I think about describing to you what Billy was to me, I think about my own mother. Her famous saying was, life is for the living. Well, it is for the living, but in Billy's case, Billy always lived in the extreme. That's who he was. And God bless him for the 42 years or so bouts that we had him, because we witnessed a lot of things. So I met him then, and then, of course, he decided to go into acting, and I was already doing some volunteer acting, that kind of thing, in the Charlotte area. We both had auditions at this Theater Charlotte for a Shakespearean play. I didn't have any clue that he was in town. He didn't have any clue that I was in town. And there he was. We're both doing this audition, and I said, is that Billy Post? No, it's Will. He had become Will now. He was Will the actor. He was Will the, what is it, Days of Our Lives or General Hospital or whatever. I said, oh, so Billy's no longer basketball. Billy's professional actor. Okay, well, this will be interesting. So I wanted to talk to him and say hi and all that, but I couldn't get to him. He'd grown up to be a extremely handsome young man, and I couldn't make my way through all the women that were around him at the audition. And I'm not kidding you. That's the truth. So we didn't get a chance to catch up very much at that point. A few years later now, down the road, 4 or 5 years, maybe, I don't remember what the time frame is, I finally get a chance to get out to Hollywood, which I'd been wanting to do for quite some time. I'd had medical issues. I was raising my own sons. Didn't have a chance to get out there. Not that I'm a big fan of Hollywood, but I was told to get your butt out there and get going. So I get out there, and there are probably 200 acting studios out there, and there are tens of thousands of actors out there trying to make a go of it. In Hollywood, 98% of the people out there never make a go of it. It's only 2% that are actually living, working people who make a living doing what they're doing. What you do when you go out there, like in my case, we had nobody out there that I knew, you go out there and you join a studio and you learn about what's going on in the industry. You meet some people, you meet young people, you meet middle-aged, and you get going with a group of people. So I rented a room in a house for $900 a month. That's a bedroom in a house in Toluca Lake. The guy who owned the house said, by the way, the person across the street's Warner Laughlin. Well, she used to live there. She has her own acting studio. I said, really? Well, that must be a sign. In Hollywood, everything is a sign. The universe is talking, all that. So I went to the Warner Laughlin studio. Now, all you scientists out there, all you doctors, all you people who have that analytical mind, give me the odds on this. This is truth. I joined the Warner Laughlin studio. And when you get joined, you are assigned a scene with a scene partner. And you and the scene partner work up a scene and present it to the class the following week. And you are evaluated, and you know, and the idea is to improve you. So I was assigned a scene from the movie In Bruges. And I had a partner by the name of Will. I didn't think a second thought about it. Will calls. Hey, my name's Will. What's yours? Jim. Oh, cool. Where are you from, Will? North Carolina. Whereabouts in North Carolina? Charlotte. What's your last name? Poston. You scientists tell me the odds on this. 200 acting studios. In each studio, there are at least 100 actors. 10,000 people out there. What are the odds of going to the same studio? The first person I have a scene with is Billy Poston. You think about that. Think about the odds on that. 1 in 100,000? I don't know. But it happened. So that's what happened out there in L.A. So it wasn't long after that. I'm not going to belabor all of this. I'll just tell you the fun stuff and the stuff that was pretty interesting. It didn't take Billy, but maybe 6 months to a year, because we spent time and time and time out there. I can't tell you how much time I spent out there. I probably spent more time with Billy out there than I did with my own sons. It wasn't long before Billy was getting auditions. He hadn't been in anything major. He'd been in some nice stuff, but he hadn't been in anything major. And I said, He called and he said, hey, Jim, can you help me with an audition? It's 2 o'clock in the morning. I said, sure, come on over. I got up. I said, Billy, what is this for? He said, it's opposite Tom Cruise. Really? Opposite Tom Cruise. He'd been out there less than a year. He was auditioning for The Mentalist. He was auditioning for all kinds of programs that you're familiar with. That guy right there, the little kid who'd never met a shot that he didn't love, was that talented. You've heard all these people tell you how talented he is and how bright he was. This is him. So I was going through my emails just the other day, and there was an email thread that we had, and he was describing to me a meeting that he had with an entertainment lawyer, a big-time entertainment lawyer, so big that the entertainment lawyer represented Russell Crowe, Brad Pitt, Viggo Mortensen. And this was from the entertainment lawyer to Billy. It said, I really want to represent you. Think about that. All of these people out there, they cannot find any representation, any agents, any managers, nothing. And he's out there for that short a period of time, and we got an entertainment lawyer that's big time wanting to represent him. That tells you what was ahead for Billy's career. That never materialized, as we know. But that was Billy. He was so proud of himself at that interview when he sat down with the entertainment lawyer. He said, Jim, I didn't even do any gee whiz moments with him. I didn't even feel like standing on the table and pretending I'm Superman with him. He was him, and he was proud of himself, and I was really, really proud of him for making it that far. I went into production, tried to get films made. He went into martial arts. Somewhere in there, I met Roseanne. At the time, he met Roseanne, and I said to Billy after Roseanne had left for the evening, I said, Billy, that's your keeper. There it is. I went back out to L.A. after coming back to take care of family business. I rented a place with two other buddies. It was Laura Wood's Apartments in Studio City. I didn't know if Billy was out there or not. We hadn't talked in a while. He didn't know if I was out there or not. I walk out of that apartment building, the first person I see is who? Will Poston. Billy Poston. Tell me the odds on that. And I'm not making any of this stuff up. I said, is that you, Billy? And I knew it was because he was wearing his cowboy boots. And he always loved to wear his cowboy boots. No matter where he was, he wanted to wear his cowboy boots. And he always had his power bars with him. He used his power bars. So those are my stories for you. I could go on and I could go on and I could go on. We would meet at all kinds of times, any night, day, whenever. Sometimes he'd go in, he'd go dark. I wouldn't hear from him for a while, whatever. We lost him. This is surreal, Pam. When I said it was more difficult than I thought it was going to be, this is it. This is just surreal. This is a guy that's 42 that had plenty of life left ahead of him, and it was going to be brilliant life no matter what he did. The martial arts people have already explained that to us, and I saw him do some of that too, and it's just unbelievable. So I'm going to finish by saying that one of his favorite sayings was beef. Dale, you know what beef means? B-E-E-F, balance, elbow, eyes, follow through. That was Jerry Faulkner's famous saying about how to shoot a basketball. Billy would make fun of Jerry, but Billy really respected Jerry Faulkner, the head basketball coach. He would make fun of everybody and love them to death. He would impersonate everybody and love them to death. What these people have said about how Billy loved people is absolutely true. I never saw anything other than that from him. And if I needed somebody to have my back, he would have my back, and same with him. So he's probably up shooting threes in God's playground right now. He's probably doing it in his cowboy boots. He's probably teaching the angels a little bit about martial arts. But he's busy up there. And Jack and Jonah, remember, boys, when you look up into that sky and you see that beautiful blue sky, let that remind you of your dad with his beautiful blue eyes that mesmerized everybody that came into contact with him. Remember him. Billy was a superhero, as we know. And the brightest star in the universe is a supernova that just explodes. Well, we've lost Billy. But when we see the brightness in the sky, Jack, that's your dad looking down on you. He'll always be there for you. Billy found peace at last. His heart gave out what was left of it. He'd given his heart to everybody he knew.
Razan told me that Billy had a favorite scripture, and it's in Isaiah, the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, begins in verse 28. Do you not know, have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary. He increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Father, thank you for this passage of Scripture and that it had an impact on this man. Thank you, Lord, for the family that that grew him to be the man that he was. Lord, we hope that you will help us today, not in understanding, but to find peace through your presence and to find comfort in our sorrow. We love you, Father, and we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. I am at a disadvantage here in that I never met Billy. It's a little tricky when that happens, but I do know some things about him. Billy had a purpose in his life. He was not an accident, and we've heard testimony to that already today. I know that he was a father who loves his children. I know that he was a husband that loved his wife. He's a brother that loved his sister, and he was a son that loved his parents. He was passionate about sports and careers and acting and all the things that we've heard talked about, and I know there were more things that he was passionate about. He had a home, a career. He had hobbies. He had many things in his life that were good. All of us are born, you know, with that same possibility. Billy had a purpose in life. And really, God has a purpose for Billy. He has a purpose for our life, just as he did for Billy's. The Bible tells us about this purpose in John 3:16, a verse that many know. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." This is God's purpose for every human being. And he doesn't just say, "I want you to have eternal life with me in heaven," but he wants to bless us now. He wants to give us good things in this life. In John 10:10, Jesus said, "I have come that you might have life and have it abundantly." God wants us to be blessed in this world. And having never met Billy, I didn't know him at all, but I think that he was a blessing to those that did know him. I think he's a blessing to those that loved him. I think that he's a blessing to all who encountered him. God has a purpose for our life. But there's a problem that is presented with every person, every human being that's ever lived. As good a man as Billy was, he was separated from God by sin. All of us have the same problem. I'm not picking on any individuals. I have that same problem. The Bible says in Romans chapter 7 that we do the things we know we shouldn't do. Even when we know we shouldn't do them, we still do them. This is sin in our lives. This is what causes us to be separated from God. It's the problem that we have. Sin is wrong. We can define that however we want. It's what we do that's wrong. God is holy. There is no sin in him. I once took a quart of oil, and I accidentally spilled it into a bucket of water, and I tried to get that oil out of the water. Now, do you know what happened, right? You can mix it, you can churn it, you can get most of it out of there, but you're never going to separate it. That's what sin does to us. It mixes up our life with this thing that God cannot tolerate. It's like God is the water and we are the oil. They don't blend. They can't be together. So this is a problem. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." We can't save ourselves. We can't get forgiveness for our sins ourselves. Proverbs 14:12 says, "There's a way that seems right to man, but in the end it leads to death." It's separation. You know, that's what death is. It's separation. And when God's word says that we are separated, we die apart from him because of our sins, it means we're separated from him. God loves us. He has a purpose for our life, but we have a problem, and that problem is our sin. But thank the Lord, God has given us a provision. Billy was an expert in martial arts. That means he would run into problems, I imagine, especially before he was an expert, when he was learning how to do martial arts. I never did martial arts, but I wrestled in school, and I learned a lot of hard lessons. I ran into problems that I couldn't solve, like every time a guy pinned me to the floor and I couldn't move, I had a problem. We all have problems. We face our problems. If we're honest with each other, our life is filled with problems. And in becoming a martial arts expert, Billy faced problems but he did not give up. We know that because he endured, he increased his skills, he moved forward, and as I understand, his martial arts opened doors in his acting career. You know, he did not give up because he had a problem. There was a provision in his life that gave him the motivation to move forward. He would find a way to solve the problem. He would find a provision to solve the problem. And I tell you this because God has not given up on us. He's provided a way to have the problem of our sin removed. And that provision is Jesus. Jesus is God's provision. Romans 5:8 says, "God demonstrated his own love towards us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Christ died for our sins. Jesus is God, and he's perfect, and he's holy. And somebody had to end the separation between humanity and him because he loves us. And he sent his son, Jesus, to take that penalty for us. Jesus is the only way for us to be forgiven of our sins and to be able to receive the hope of eternity in heaven. John 14:6, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me." We have purpose in life, but we have a problem. And God has made a provision for that problem to be removed, to be solved. God loves us so much that he sent his only son to die for our sins. Today we have a choice to make. I am told that Billy faced this choice, and he chose to accept God's provision. This is what I've been told. I've never met him, but I believe that that is true. If somebody can see that provision in his life, then it would be true. Jesus tells us all that we have to make a choice. We have to. Some might think, well, I don't have to, or I don't want to, or I'm going to walk away, or I'm not dealing with that, or I don't believe what you're saying. That's fine. You still have to make the choice. It can't be pushed aside. Eventually, everyone will decide what to do with Jesus. They're going to have to decide about the forgiveness that God offers us in Christ. There's a saying I heard many years ago in regards to this matter, and it said, to decide, not to decide, is to decide. It is a decision to say, yes, I want the forgiveness God offers only in Jesus Christ, or to say, no, I don't want God's provision or forgiveness of our sins. We all choose one or the other. Accept or reject his gift of eternal life. We accept Jesus by faith. John chapter 1, verse 12, but as many received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. We accept Christ by faith. We allow him to be the Lord of our life. Romans 10:9, one of the most powerful passages in the whole Bible. It says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God is raising from the dead, you will be saved from your sins. It's so simple. Confess with the mouth and believe that God raised his son from the dead. God so strongly wants all of us to accept this gift that he's given to us, that he has told us that I will die for you. I will make this sacrifice before you make the decision. Romans 5:8, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God so strongly wants us to be saved, to be forgiven, to have eternal life. There's a story in the Bible where Jesus is hanging on the cross. Most of us probably in this room have heard this story. And there are men to the right and to his left. And the one man is there hanging on the cross with Jesus, and he ridicules Jesus. He says, if you are who you say you are, take us down off this cross and give us life. The other man is silent until near the end. When he looks at Jesus and he said, Master, today when you enter into your kingdom, will you remember me? And Jesus said to this man who was a thief and a murderer, who had never been to church a day in his life, had never done anything that we know of that's good. He probably did some good things, but he's been punished for a severe crime. And he just says, please remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus looked at him and said, today you will be with me in paradise. If there was ever an undeserving man, it was him. He didn't do anything that we think that they must do to be saved. Jesus simply said, you showed faith. You confessed that I am your master. I am the Lord. Today you'll be with me in paradise. It's very simple, really. There are no prerequisites to God's offer. You don't have to get perfect. You don't have to fix yourself. You don't have to go to church or pray perfect prayers. In essence, we're all like the thief on the cross. When I came to Christ, I was a drug addict. I was a drug dealer. I was a violent man. I was a biker. I beat people up. I did stupid things. I was an alcoholic, but I would rather do drugs than alcohol because in my warped way of thinking, I thought I won't be hungover tomorrow if I don't get drunk. But the people I ran with, it all went together. It was all together. And I spent years like that. And I had a man that came to me, and he just loved me where I was. He didn't try to change me. He didn't. That's not his job. That's not the ability that he was given. But God's love began to settle into my heart, and I began to realize that I needed to make the decision that I'm talking about today. We all hurt. If we're honest with each other, we're all a mess. I'm a mess. Let's be honest, you're a mess. What God does is takes our mess and makes something beautiful out of it. I believe that from what Miss Daly shared with me many times over the last couple of weeks, that Billy made that decision. He may not have been in church every week, but he doesn't have to be. He may not have prayed the most perfect prayers, but he doesn't have to. He didn't have to be perfect in every way. He's just like the thief on the cross, just like you and I were the thief on the cross. And at some day in his life, he said, Lord, remember me when you enter your kingdom. And Jesus said, Billy, it's not today, but in the year 2022, you're going to be with me in paradise. It's an amazing thing what God has done for us. We have to make a choice. You can't deny it. You can't get away from it. I know some in here are even now thinking, I don't want to hear this. But the truth is, we all face the same situation. The day comes when we are separated from our loved ones. There's a day after that when we will be separated from God because we're in sin unless we make a decision to receive Jesus by faith. You can make that decision today to follow Jesus and accept God's provision for the forgiveness of your sin. You can simply just do what the Bible says in Romans 10:9. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, Jesus, remember me today when you enter into your kingdom. You can do that. You can say, God, I believe that you are who you say you are. I believe that you rose on the third day from the dead. Why is that important? It's important because that tells us that Jesus is God. I've never known anybody that comes back to life after 3 days of you, but he did. Over 500 people saw him after he died. Jesus, I believe in you. I don't understand all of it, but I believe. I accept that you're holy and without sin, and that you sent your son Jesus who died for me so that I can live eternally. I'm sorry for the price that my sin caused Jesus to pay. Like the thief on the cross, I ask you to accept me today. Father, thank you for this truth. I thank you for the life of William Poston. I pray, Father, that he looks down today and that he sees the people here. And I know that if he could speak to us, he would say that it's true. I pray that a person here, many here maybe, I don't know, that maybe this is the day that they make that decision in their own heart. They don't have to come forward. They don't have to pray a prayer. They simply must confess you and believe with in all their heart and all their life that you are the Son of God. We do love you today, and we thank you for the life that we celebrate this day. In Billy Poston, in Jesus' name, amen. Razan gave me a prayer that Billy loved, right, Razan? And it's a prayer for my son. And so I'm going to read this, and we're going to have a song, and then we're going to proceed to go to the graveside. It says, a prayer for my son, and this hangs on the wall in Jack's room. And he gave it to his son. Dear God, your gifts are many, and I'm grateful for every one. One of the greatest gifts you've given is the gift of my dear son. Thank you for his life, dear Lord. Watch over him each day. May he be safe and free from harm as he goes about his way. Bless him through life's trials. Help him choose right from wrong. An example be for all to see, standing tall, proud, and strong. Amen.
Sweetest little fella, everybody knows. Don't know what to call him, but he's mighty like a rose. Looking at his mama with eyes so shiny blue, makes you think that heaven might be coming close to you. When he's there asleepin' in his little place, think I see the angels lookin' through the lace. When the dark is fallin' and when the shadows creep, then they come on tiptoe to kiss him in his sleep. Sweetest little fella, Everybody knows, don't know what to call him, but he's mighty like a rose. Looking at his mama with eyes so shiny blue, makes you think that heaven is a coming close to you.
But you're not, cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones that today, toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the drinks bring back all the memories, and the memories bring back your. There's a time that I remember when I did not know no pain, when I believed in forever and everything would stay the same. Now my heart feels like December when somebody say your name, cause I can't reach out to call you, but I know I will one day, yeah. Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts someday, yeah, yeah. But everything gon' be alright, gon' raise a glass and say, hey. Here's to the ones that we got, cheers to the wish you were here but you're not, cause the dreams bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones in today, toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the dreams bring back all the memories, and the memories bring back your. There's a time that I remember when I never felt so lost, and I felt all of the hatred was too powerful to stop. Oh, yeah. Now my heart feels like an ember, and it's lighting up the dark. I'll carry these torches for you, and you know I'll never drop. Yeah. Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts someday, yeah, yeah. But everything gon' be alright. Say, hey. Here's to the ones that we got, oh, cheers to the wish you were here but you're not, cause the dreams bring back all the memories of everything.